Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship on this very slick Sunday morning. Those of you who are watching online, this sounds about right. Those of you who are watching this online later don't know how slippery the roads were. So thank you very much for everyone who are here in person, and a special welcome to those who are worshiping with us online. As we gather for worship on this glorious day, I'll remind you, it is annual meeting today, so don't run off, come have some food. Let's hear about all the wonderful things we accomplished in the past year, and let us look forward together and brainstorming what our hopes for being a body of Christ this coming year shall be. So with that, I invite you to center your hearts and your minds on our ever-present and loving God as we prepare for worship with an opening hymn, number
817.
Huzzah!
Down to the lake shore.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin. Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us, that we may be reconciled to one another. For your holy name. Amen. Thus says the Lord our God, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We turn to our Kyrie, setting 3.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Our hymn of praise is "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." You may remain standing, but please know you are allowed to sit. 742, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus."
Thank you.
Lord God, your loving kindness always goes before us and follows after us. Summon us into your light and direct our steps in the ways of goodness that come through the cross of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated as we turn to God's word.
Our first reading is from Isaiah. There will be no gloom for those who are in anguish. In the former time, the Lord brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you, as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read responsively Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom then shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
One thing I ask of the Lord, one thing I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek God in the temple.
For in the day of trouble, God will give me shelter. Hide me in the hidden places of the sanctuary, and raise me high upon a rock.
Even now my head is lifted up above my enemies who surround me. Therefore I will offer sacrifice in the sanctuary, sacrifices of rejoicing. I will sing and make music to the Lord.
Hear my voice, O Lord, when I call. Have mercy on me and answer me.
My heart speaks your message. Seek my face. Your face, O Lord, I will seek.
Hide not your face from me. Turn not away from your servant in anger. Cast me not away. You have been my helper. Forsake me not, O God, of my salvation. Our second reading is from 1 Corinthians. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and of the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite the congregation to please rise as we turn to our gospel acclamation. From the Gospel of Matthew, the fourth chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and for those who sat in the region and the shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James of Zebedee and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in the synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. How many of you played tag growing up? How many of you, so my favorite version of, I didn't really like the just run for running's sake, but I was hooked on tag when some Lutheran counselors came for Vacation Bible School and taught us a version of freeze tag. So I'm oddly specific about what version of tag I like. How many of you have heard of toilet tag? Yeah, no, okay. This went a little rockier at the first service, Quinn can attest to this. So a version of tag that I grew up playing, you would run and someone would tag you and you would have to get down on one knee and here's your little flusher and someone would have to come sit on your knee to unfreeze you and flush you. You'd have to make like the better the toilet sound you made, the better. So I tried to like get the kids to play this at first service, and when I got down my hand, like, you'd sit this and flush all their faces. It turns out it's mostly a South Dakota thing, but there were some other people who remember toilet tag. Toilet tag, I think, is especially profound because when we think about what we do at the beginning of service, we come to worship and we confess the sins that we don't want to be carrying around. I have children who struggle with constipation. And when you carry around heavy, uncomfortable burdens, whether they're sin or naturally, biologically happen, it's uncomfortable. We have to find some way to let it go. And it can be just as uncomfortable to let go of our sins and the things that we are ashamed of or feel guilty about as it is to remember to take your Miralax and let nature take its course. So I always like to drop with the confirmants and the younger kiddos, toilet tag. I guess it's been long enough since I used this as an example. The youth were just horrified. So I'm sharing this part with you guys. If you struggle to connect with why we come here and look towards a cross and why the pastor shows you the unkempt back part of her hair, because I just can't be bothered to look at it in the mirror, and you don't connect with giving our sins to a cross so that they be absolved, imagine flushing them down the toilet. The things that God does not want you carrying around, that are causing you pain, that are limiting the way you are able to live your life and love around other people. Everyone's going to be driving home doing their toilet sound. Well, that's really good. And just be like, oh, yeah, mm-hmm, yeah, that's not a good one. And you're just, it's gone. That's forgiven. But, in the words of Mr. Rogers, you can never go down the drain. And you can never be flushed down the toilet. You are secure, but we let go of the heavy stuff. And if you haven't, let's just take a moment. Okay, God, maybe we thought of a couple of things since you absolved us in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay, we thought of other ones. Everyone do a little toilet sound. Oh, we don't have a lot of sinners in church today, you guys. I'm sorry, that was just me. You are absolved in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit by me, pastor, and ordained one, but mostly by Christ. Christ, who is eager to catch you. Now, I didn't like running for running's sake, and I thought it was because I was lazy as a kid. No, I just conserved my energy for different things like crafting, which was far superior than running. Jesus wants to catch you up in his love. And so he sends disciples out to catch people for the sake of the gospel. So when you think about Tay, whether you loved it or not, I wonder if that impacts the way we listen to this gospel story. Do I want to be caught in God's love? Like, do I feel like I'm falling backwards into this really scary trust fall? Like I'm a trapeze artist and I'm falling and God's net is going to catch me and I'm going to be safe and secure? Or are things going like just fine? And I being caught up in God's love is almost like being a fish trapped in a net. Am I going to be caught and set free? Now, there are crab fishermen who they'll whatever they catch in the net, if it's a female crab or a female sort of fish, like they can tell. And so they'll put a band around its neck, a leg, to make sure that other people don't accidentally catch it. Like this one is meant to be, wow, what a beautiful crab. And then you toss it back in the ocean. Is that what it's going to feel like? You're seen, you're loved, you're valued, and then you're set free? Or is it going to be a little bit more like Finding Nemo? You're caught and you're put in this little inky-binky tank to just be there until you're flushed down the toilet someday. We have a fish tank. I am ashamed to say it goes pretty long in between cleanings. Like we have some pretty resilient fish in our house, and I have flushed many a fish down the toilet. My girls, they're heartless. They don't care. Oh, fish tank, whatever. So I make the funeral procession with the fish in the net to the toilet, and I drop it in, and I give a thanks for this life's all creatures great and small that God has blessed us with, and then I flush the toilet by myself. And sometimes, when we think about being caught in God's love, if we're feeling spiritually fed and spiritually well, being caught up in God's love sounds marvelous. It sounds like a spa day. God just gave give you attention and remind you that you're loved so you can go back and tackle the next week. But if you're depleted and you're exhausted and you're questioning what it means to receive God's love, what is God's love? What is the promise of Jesus Christ? Dun, dun, dun. Getting caught in that net sounds scary. Being made a fisher of people sounds beautiful. If you feel like you're being fed, if you feel like you're rested, if you feel like you belong in the church, and you feel like you have solid footing, but it sounds like a monumental task when you're not sure if you are a fish or a person. Am I the one that gets caught and eaten to feed other disciples? Like, am I like that? Oh, she's too beautiful to eat. Set her back free to make more fishes and more disciples. Sounds like a trap if it means we're going to be caught. So I think it's important to remind you that there's a reason we have a first reading and a second reading and a psalm and a gospel. People spent hundreds of years lining up our lectionaries. Because it's not just about being caught in love, you know, caught in a net and, oh, I've caught this many fish and you've caught that many fish. We're remembering who is the one we are catching for. Who is the one who is catching us? It is Christ. It is God that we know in the Holy Spirit who is catching us. Paul reminds us in our second reading that you are not owned by, nor do you belong to, the people who pass on the faith to you. Connected to them, spiritually enriched by them, deeply moved, yes. But you do not belong to them, you belong to Christ. When Paul points this out to the Colossians, you know, Chloe sends him a letter and she says, Paul, my people are fighting and I cannot get them all on the same page. So it'd be like Paul is like the bishop. You call the bishop in and be like, let's get all on the same page. Let's resolve this issue. And he says, you don't belong to me, Paul. You don't belong to Apollos. You don't belong to Cephas. It's a lot like in our modern day saying, well, I'm a Lutheran. Or my version, like, which is really bad. Like, I'm a Lutheran, but I'm the ELCA one. We're the one that is like, allows females to be pastors. Which is a hard thing to say because I've met many of Missouri Synod people because I grew up attending Sunday school in Missouri Synod. So I love going to Missouri Synod churches from time to time to remember that part of my faith formation. But then they're always surprised, oh, you can come be our pastor. And I have to be like, I can't. Because you don't ordain women. So it would actually be super duper offensive for us to continue this conversation for the sake of the leaders you call to your church, who you love, who you lead. So I am just like a nasty truth bomb when I need my Missouri Synod fix. Like, you can't, you guys don't ordain women. It's not a criticism. That's just me telling you. So when people say, when I say I'm a Lutheran, I have to be like, yeah, I'm ELCA Lutheran. But don't judge me yet, because I came from a bunch of Haugians, which very few people know what that means. It's like a, it's almost like me using 50 Cent as a reference to rappers. No kid knows who 50 Cent is. I got called up by the parents. They're like, Pastor Carrie, stick to your Pokemon Power Ranger references. We don't belong to Lutheranism. We don't belong to Presbyterianism. We belong to Christ. When we are baptized, you are baptized a Christian. You're not baptized a Carrion, because I've finally done baptisms now. And as beautiful and wonderful as it is to remember the pastors who have baptized us and the wonderful faith connections we have to those who baptize our children, you don't belong to those pastors, you belong to Christ. And this is important, because Christ unites us. We are Christians. We belong to a triune God. We do not belong to a denomination. We do not belong to a doctrine. We belong to a God who is mysterious and far vast and wider than we can ever comprehend. When ministers who baptize us fail to live into the versions of disciples that they could be, your baptism does not lose its promise or its potency. I've had many friends that I've talked to who lost connection with the church because a pastor that they so loved made a mistake that caused that pastor to move to a different church or consider their profession, but it was such a horrible wound, it made them lose trust in their baptism. When a youth leader or a Sunday school teacher or a parent or a friend, or how about a spiritual author? How much of us put so much weight on theologians who sound so eloquent? We put so much weight into them. We read all of their books, and then we get to their midlife crisis book, and we're like, I don't agree with that. And instead of it just being a conversation between us and that person, it becomes us not trusting in Christ anymore, not us trusting the promise of baptism, the promise of communion. Your baptism is not lost when those who encourage you in the faith fail. When you are frozen in life, in your spiritual life, and you're, like as a freeze tag, when you're that toilet, you are not lost. God knows exactly where you are. He knows exactly what you're going through. If it was good enough for Jesus, for God, if it was good enough for God to come to earth to be Jesus, I think we can talk about bowel movements from the pulpit. If it helps us remember that we set aside the things of which we are ashamed, because we do believe the promise in that water. We believe in the promise of the water more than we believe in the pastors who preach our gospel messages, more than we believe in our doctrines that we revise for the sake of good living. We believe in the promise of Christ above and beyond everything else. As Paul says, "For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Paul baptized, but he didn't come primarily to baptize, he came to preach. And not with eloquent wisdom. But we hold Paul's words so far superior than the words we use to express our own. But Paul understands that Christ is always going to be more eloquent than us. Christ is always going to be more powerful than us. Christ is always going to be more loving and more forgiving, more gracious and more merciful than we could ever be. So when we catch fish or people for the sake of Christ, it's not really us doing the catching, it's the Holy Spirit. We come in contact with them. We preach the good news. We remind them that they are loved, that there is redemption, that there is a hope and a way of living in God's truth, and in that, the Holy Spirit catches them. For our congregation here and our congregation at St. Andrew's that we partner with, this scripture touches on something that I've heard us talking about for years. Talks about our need to belong, not just to Christ, but our need to belong to each other. We need to be seen, we need to be known, and we need to be loved by those around us. This is not to blame you or shame you. That's totally a thing. Runa is really into scrapbooking. She's found my scrapbooks, and I cannot tell you, neon pink and neon yellow were not my colors. Right? That's why I poked up on the yellow. That's my color for you. I wore so much glitter, and I can still remember the smell of those 1990s roll-on glitters, and it's back. Or those like those headbands that would like scrunch your hair back really tight, but it felt like talons were being dug into your head. I needed and wanted to belong so bad as a young teenager, like as a tween and a teenager, that I stopped and I looked and like, that does not look like something I would have worn at all. Like I was the muted green and sweatshirt with almost matching sweatpants. Like that was me. That's when I felt most like myself. Leave me alone with my Harry Potter and my Nancy Drew and we're gonna go on just fine. But I see all these trends when I go back to my pictures, I'm like, oh yeah, that's when I was trying to fit in with Heather. That's when I was trying to fit in with Brittany. And that's when I met Elizabeth and I went totally anime, although that was actually just like a really good fit, Elizabeth. We all want to belong, and sometimes we bend ourselves backwards to belong when we forget you already belong. In your baptism, you belong in Christ, and you belong to Christ, and so Christ belongs to you. So wherever you go, at any time, to any distance or any proximity place, you belong. You belong in yourself, and you belong in Christ, and Christ belongs in you. Sometimes it matters more to us that we belong to those around us than it matters to us that we belong to Christ and that we understand how we belong to ourselves. Because I can identify with Paul not being eloquent, I'm going to use someone's words who are eloquent, from Brené Brown. Quote, "A deep sense of loving and belonging is a need of all people. We are biologically, cognitively, physically, and spiritually wired to love, to be loved, and to belong. And when those needs are not met, we do not function as we are meant to. We break, we fall apart, we numb, we ache, we hurt others, we get sick." End quote. Belonging is important to us. It's natural to us. It seems super duper hard to do. And this isn't just a kid thing or a teenage thing. This is like an adult thing. I spent a week in Arizona watching retirees try and make friends. And it triggered me back to junior high, trying to make friends for the first time I went to a Baptist youth group. I go back to the hotel room and just do deep breaths. I mean, that felt very dicey. I felt how all the stakes were raised. Will you be my friend? Will you play pickleball with me? Can we get along? To not belong is to be found unworthy of acceptance. I will quote Gary Zukav for this one. Unworthiness is the inmost frightening thought that you do not belong, no matter how much you want to belong, that you are an outsider and you will always be an outsider. It is the idea that you are flawed and cannot be fixed. Unworthiness is wanting to be loved and feeling unlovable, or wanting to love and feeling that you are not capable of loving. End quote. We want to belong, that is natural. We want to be found worthy, that is a need. We yearn to be accepted. But we are afraid to be caught. We fear that it will be painful or that it will be shameful. We fear telling people who we are and the things that we like, because what if they don't value those unique aspects of ourselves? What if we enter the net of God's love that the disciples cast only to be flushed down a toilet, to be put in a tank and forgotten until we die because we are found uninteresting. We are considered unworthy or unlovable. Being caught in a spiritual sense, as Jesus is telling his disciples, means that you will see people and you will love people and you will accept people and you will aid them in being set free through Christ's love so that they can keep on living. But we fight against the net of God's love because we can't separate God's love from the broken aspects and versions of love that we've known in the world. We don't want Jesus to come tell us, well, it's going to be okay. Your anxiety, your depression, your fear, it's going to be okay. Because when we tell each other that, it's not okay. Nothing feels worse than to have an irrational anxiety phase. And sometimes people are like a day and sometimes like a week. We're in seasonal depression time, guys. You all know someone, whether they told you or not, that struggles with seasonal depression. And they're like, it's going to be fine. And on the inside, we're like, but it's not going to be fine. And so when Jesus says, it's going to be fine, we're like, but it's not going to be fine. And Jesus is like, no, it's okay. I've got you. It is going to be fine. It's going to be uncomfortable. It's going to take a while for the Miralax to work, but it's going to be fine. Because I have so many hands since the end of October. We have done the ritual in my house of I sit on this little, I'm going to break this little wooden chair, and it's antique too. I should probably just like invest in like a real chair. I sit knee to knee with my kiddos and I hold their hands. I'm like, it's okay. You just got to take deep breaths and breathe through it. It's going to work itself out. It's going to be okay. So then when I'm struggling to write my sermon, be like, I just got to imagine Jesus holding my hands. Be like, it's going to come out, Pastor Carrie. It's going to be fine. You're going to come up with a sermon. This will pass. Oh, my goodness. We want to belong. We need to be found worthy. We long for acceptance. We yearn for that peace that passes understanding, that does quiet our anxiety and our fear and our doubt and our depression and our self-loathing. Quote Mother Teresa, if we have no peace, it is because we have forgotten that we belong to each other. You belong to Christ, and you belong in Christ, and Christ resides within your heart and within your spirit. And because you belong in Christ and Christ belongs to you, we actually all belong to each other. We belong to each other. Some of us know what it is to know the safety and the hope of being accepted, to be caught when you're falling, to be reminded that you are redeemed, and to be found worthy in the sight of Christ and his disciples. But some of you and us know the lure of faith traditions or theologies or communities that either intentionally or unintentionally trap us in our shame. They do not set us free. Hear this good news that Paul and other eloquent people have preached long before I was given the chance. In baptism, you belong to Christ. Nothing can take that away. Not death, not embarrassment, not teenage disasters, not midlife crises. Nothing can take Christ away from you. Nothing can change that you belong in Christ. We're a small enough group and we have enough time. I'm going to invite you to turn to someone in your pew. Trust me. You're going to be just fine. I'm holding your hands. I'm holding your hands or knee to knee. One or both of us are on the come on. It's going to be fine. Turn to someone next to you. Look them in the eye. Make eye contact and say, you belong. Yep, go for it. You belong. You belong. Okay, now find someone who's not close to you. Like, look way back there. You belong. You belong. You belong. Now it's like, now we're going to break out with who is the unsinkable Molly Brown? She was Princess Leia's mom. She was in Singing in the Rain.
Debbie Reynolds,
you're my friend and you'll stay my friend. Doesn't matter what the other people say. You belong here. You will always belong here. And you belong here, even though you're worshiping with us online, like you still belong here. And you belong where you will go later today because you belong and are secure in Christ. Nothing can take that from you. Don't let your own brain talk you out of it. Take some more vitamin D. I hear magnesium is good. Take a nap. Eat something. Hydrate. Find someone who will hold your hand and pray with you. It will be okay. This too shall pass. God's love is catching you. And God's love is surrounding you gently and compassionately so that you may live today and forever as a child of God who belongs in whatever space you are inhabiting. And for this good news, we give thanks and we say amen.
Amen.
For this good news, we move on after this good news to our hymn of the day, 818. You may rise as you are able. Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of the heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Make your church one in purpose, proclaiming the message of the cross. Help us to work together across differences. energize ecumenical partnerships, including the World Council of Churches and Lutheran World Federation. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We rejoice at the bounty of your creation. Fill the land and sea with your abundance. Bless harvest in the southern hemisphere and fallow fields in the northern. Equip farmers to till and keep the earth sustainably. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
In Christ, your reign comes near and calls all to repentance. Break the rod of the oppressor in every nation. Dispel the shadow of death in places of war and persecution. Grant us leaders who lift the yokes that burden those in need. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Be a stronghold for those in trouble and a rock for all who are afraid. Rouse communities to care for neighbors who need shelter, are facing maltreatment, or are isolated and lonely. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Sustain the ministries of this congregation and all churches in this community. Nurture each congregation's unique witness to your presence. Foster mutual respect. Inspire our cooperation in loving our neighbors. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We praise you for the faithful who have gone ahead of us, both famous and unknown, eloquent and simple spoken. Help us to leave our nets and follow, and bring us with them to the fullness of your promise of eternal life. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We bring to you our needs and hopes, O God, trust in your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
At this time, I invite you to share a sign of Christ's peace with those who are around you. And just in case they forgot, you can remind them that they belong. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace.
I know it.
Please be seated as we turn to a time of offering.
You break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power, and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore through Jesus our Savior.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, he blessed it, and gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you. For the forgiveness of sin, do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Sin lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Come, taste, and see that the Lord is good. All are welcome. You may be seated. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. Strengthen you. as you are able. And let us pray.
Holy One, we thank you for the healing that springs forth abundantly from this table. Renew our strength to do justice, love kindness, and journey humbly with you.
Amen. A couple of announcements. Don't forget to come eat food. Come for annual meeting. Remove the annual meeting booklets. They're in the office right now, but we didn't want them to distract you from worship. So we'll bring them into the fellowship hall. Make sure you get some food and eat. And then I'll also, this is one of the stoles that our quilters have been making. This is an example of what will be given to the synod to give to first call pastors or those who are new. So that's just beyond gorgeous, something I hope to aspire to be someday when I'm not busy holding hands knee to knee, doing that stuff. But in the weeks to come, these will be blessed and they'll be sent. But it's how one of the ways that we're trying to live into that promise to raise up leaders in all the world for the sake of the gospel. This week marked the first ordination of a female pastor in Palestine. And so many, our bishop, Bishop Curran, who is marvelously fantastic. I hope you can all come for our Synod Assembly revival at Grandview this summer to meet her. She is there celebrating and giving blessings. So simple things like stoles here are just as important as traveling overseas to mark a moment in history with our brothers and sisters around the world. Because who knows, maybe some of you in your second career will become an ordained pastor, or maybe some of the youth in our congregation will become pastors. But that's a beautiful way we can help inspire and encourage those that I am blessed to call colleague and brother and sister in Christ.
Can I add to that?
Yes.
So if anybody has old cotton sheets, we use them in the inside of those. So if you have some old ones that you don't want anymore, or don't throw them away, bring them to me, because I can, even if it has a hole in it, I can cut out around the holes and stuff, especially if they're light colored. Yeah. We got a couple dark ones, but.
But then they don't, your sheets, when you throw them out, they don't go to landfill, they get repurposed and reused. And special thank you to Nazareth Lutheran in Cambridge, because they did send me a bunch of sheets.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, so we got sheets to keep making up. So hopefully this will be something that we can continue to do together and pray over them. But I think it's time to eat. Let's say a quick blessing. Gracious God, we give you thanks for those who have provided food that will sustain us through remembering the past year and planning for the year ahead. Bless this food to our bodies, and may your spirit reside within us. In your name we pray. Amen. Now it's probably time for a blessing. The God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod, bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always. Amen. Please join us in our sending hymn 815.
Our source of Thanks be to God.